Hey everyone, in this video we're going to be looking at Chapter 4 of Pragmatic Programmer, which is called Pragmatic Paranoia. One of my mentors from many years ago told me this bit of wisdom: sometimes code is ugly because life is ugly. That stuck with me to this day, and I hope it's lodged in the back of your mind now too. Humans are imperfect, and thus anything that comes out of our minds will end up being imperfect too, even with the best of care and intentions. The intro of this chapter starts out with the axiom, as the authors say, that we can't write perfect software. With that being the case, what's the right response? Should we despair, knowing that the product of our life's work is doomed to imperfection? Fortunately, no. And truth be told, imperfection would follow people into any role or job in any industry. So it's worth picking one where you can still find success, in spite of your humanity. So this chapter is essentially about that: mindsets and practices around what makes software defect-proof, even though it can never be perfect. Maybe defect-resistance would be a better way to say that than defect-proof. One of the common threads, hence why it made it into the title of the chapter, is paranoia. Why it's important. And the intro ends with a quote from Woody Allen saying, "When everyone is actually out to get you, paranoia is just good thinking." The first section of the chapter talks about the concept of designing by contract. Your code will be a part of and or will interact with the work of many other people and teams. It will likely even work with other companies' code bases if you integrate with external APIs. As a result, there is a huge need to have a contract of behavior between all of the interacting pieces so that the moving pieces can be depended on to work together as expected. What I mean by contract is an implicit or explicit agreement that your code will behave in a certain way, that others' code will behave in another way, and since those two ways are compatible with each other, the end result will be that the broader system of programs will work together to accomplish a lot more than the sum of the individual parts. This has been kind of abstract, and so let's try to be more specific with what this entails. The authors ask the question, what is a correct program? And the answer is one that does no more and no less than what it claims to do. What a program claims to do has a few aspects to it: preconditions, postconditions, and invariants. The first and second are the inputs and outputs. Let's say you have a function that multiplies a number by 2. The input is the number to be multiplied, and the output is the product of the original numbers being multiplied. The invariant here would be a constraint saying that the input has to be a number and thus will reject or fail gracefully if a user inputs a letter, for example. Based on these aspects, we can predict the behavior of any input, and a programmer that comes later will be able to use the function easily without having to worry about what behavior is happening under the hood. As a follow-up to this, writing unit tests is a good way of documenting code because they show what the code will give in response to various inputs. Some people use test-driven development to make sure that their business requirements are all supported up front before they even start writing any of the code. Personally, I think that TDD requires more foresight than is reasonable, especially considering the emergent nature of design in code, in the sense that it constrains what the final outcome will look like and doesn't leave room for serendipity as much as just starting to write and seeing how the code evolves over the course of the feature's work. But I see the appeal of test-driven development, and for those that it works for, that is good for them. The next section is called Dead Programs Tell No Tales. It's about unexpected errors. So the authors start out by pointing out that sometimes others can tell if you have a problem before you do, and that the same thing applies to code and coding as well. When we write code, there's a tendency to think that we've covered the expected behavior but the dark side is forgetting to add support for all the errors that could possibly come, whether from bad inputs, malformed inputs, no inputs, and so on. There's always more that can go wrong because we can't guarantee what a function will be used for in the future. With that being the case, the suggestion is to have error handling built in, and I would even add with just as much intentionality as with the intended behavior. Prioritize error handling, prioritize graceful failures to ensure that crashes aren't fatal to the application as a whole, and ideally that any error messages that are generated in the process are logged through an observability service that allows you and others to look into them later. The next section is called Assertive Programming and deals with this mantra, quote, "This can never happen." I find myself falling into this trap sometimes, often thinking that I've covered all the bases of possible behavior or that I've created functions with a constrained enough range of behavior that there isn't any uncertainty that hasn't been accounted for already. And the tricky thing is that I'm usually right. Being usually right is a rough spot to be in if you're introspective enough, because it lulls you into a false sense of security that leads to missing the instances where you are wrong. One of the ways to constrain ranges of behavior is with assertions in the code, or tests. When you add tests to your code, these will always run, and as long as they're passing, you can be assured that the program is behaving in accordance with those assertions. I like to have a few different types of tests. The first type is tests which show that something does what you expect it to do. The second type is tests which show that something does not do what you don't expect it to do. And the third type is tests that show if someone misused the function entirely, that the function would degrade gracefully and demonstrate to that user where they've gone astray. So an example of the first would be with the expected input, you get the intended output. An example of the second would be that if some valid but out of range inputs are given, that the function doesn't go off the rails. Lastly would be an example for if someone gives a bad input, such as integers when a string is expected, or null inputs and so on, the program shouldn't crash and shouldn't instead tell the user where they strayed. The next section is about memory allocation, which is probably less applicable as time goes on, and more of that is handled automatically by the languages and frameworks of the modern era. So I'll skip that one for now. The last section is called Don't Outrun Your Headlights, and it's an interesting, if cautionary, idiom about how and why being too aggressive in the development process is a recipe for disaster. The saying essentially means that if someone is going too fast and can't see of where they're driving or programming, as the case may be, the danger of swerving off into oblivion increases quite a bit. Therefore, the way to mitigate this is to always take small steps, especially when navigating unknown territory. Continuing the driving slash programming analogy, there's a need to move intentionally, iteratively, and seeking feedback continually from people who can offer insights into your blind spots or have already gone where you are going. So the question is, what should we be doing to not outrun our headlights, as they say? The trick is to not take on tasks that are too big and too foreign. Test something for being too big or too foreign to our knowledge can be accomplished by utilizing unit tests, running code in a REPL separately from the rest of your code base, and or demoing for others a set of changes before committing them. So that's one set of things. Another thing to do is catch yourself fortune-telling and stop yourself from that line of inquiry. To some extent, you can see into the near future in terms of what your users will want and need, but to a larger extent, what the future holds is a mystery, and you should act and build in a way that you think is suitable for the long term, but at the same time, without so much opinion that you'll be surprised or disappointed when the winds change or there are black swan events. So that's all for this video. I don't make any money off of these videos at this point in time, but rather for the sake of my own learning and to share that learning experience with you. If you found this video and series helpful and thought-provoking, I'd appreciate a like, subscribe, and comment. I love hearing from you, and we'll see you all in the next one.